Παίζει.
Okay, so I think we're going to start. So welcome to this presentation about turning your monolithic applications into microservices using a WildFly Swarm. My name is Dimitris Andreadis. I work for Red Hat, and I lead the team that makes the WildFly community project, the application server, and also the enterprise application platform, which is our supported product for Red Hat. For me, it started quite some time ago, something like 13 years ago. I took the red pill, as they used to say, and started working professionally on open source. So there was a little known project called JBoss. I was a contributor. And back then, JBoss hired me to work for JBoss remotely from Athens and so on. It's all history now. You can read about it. It's been quite an amazing journey for me. So what we're going to talk today, I'm going to give you my take on microservices. It's quite a buzzword, so I'll try to you know, analyze it a bit, what I think it means. Then we're going to talk very briefly about WildFly architecture, just enough to get an introduction to Swarm. And then we're going to talk about Swarm, how you get started, and you know, how you can configure it. So just to help me, you know, who knows about WildFly Swarm? Perfect. No one knows about Swarm. So you came to the right place. So let's talk about microservices. So who's doing microservices? Okay, and who wants to do microservices? The next, many. Excellent. So, yeah, microservices to me look something like this. This metaphor. So imagine you want to fly, right? So how you fly now? You book a ticket online, long in advance. You go to the airport, check in your bags, go through security, wait at the gate, board the plane. You have various restrictions. You know, you cannot use your mobile phone on takeoff and landing. And then you have this huge plane developed over whatever, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40 years, hundreds of subsystems. Why you need all that, you know? And on the right, you have this guy with a paramotor. I just need a seat, a parachute, an engine, a little bit of fuel, and a helmet for safety. Safety first. And you can even take selfies. You can use your phone, right? Isn't that great? So what are microservices? We kind of know empirically what it involves. So it's a bit like SOA. Who knows what is SOA? The older guys know about SOA. Sorry about that. So service-oriented architecture, you know, you central hub, you send messages, you transfer them, you send them out. It's like SOA, but without the central hub. You can use any programming language, which is cool. You don't have to write specifically Java. You can use the language that's fit for the purpose. You need the two-pizza team. That's a very important rule, right? Because microservices are made by smaller teams. So there's this rule that two pizzas can feed the whole team. And then, of course, you break up the older, bigger system into smaller pieces. And this is where the micro normally comes in. That encapsulates some vertical aspects, meaning that you try to control the full stack from the web interface to the database, so your service is a bit independent. And then you would normally use some sort of Docker container, some orchestration engine like Kubernetes, you know, all this machinery. So, yeah, it has to be small, yeah? Did I say small? And why do microservices? I think it boils down to three reasons. Everyone does it, okay? Everyone does it, almost. Second, because you want to go internet scale. And what do we mean internet scale? You have millions of clients. And who has millions of clients in their applications? Okay, we have a few. And the truth is that microservices really evolved out of those internet scale companies that they just couldn't solve the problem otherwise, like Google, Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat. You know, you cannot scale to these numbers with traditional technology. Traditional technology, we kind of know what to do. We can scale to tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands if you separate your user base properly. So we can do that. But the real reason for doing microservices is because you want to go fast. And when we say fast, we mean, you know, you have a mobile phone. There are companies that deploy, that was a new update, weekly. They can update weekly, right? How soon you can update your project? And I see there the Amazon sign. You know, in Amazon, they deploy daily. Sometimes they deploy multiple times per day. So sooner or rather than later, someone in the market that you operate will come, and they will be able to do that kind of stuff, put out features very, very, very fast, and then you will have to act. It's better that you act earlier. So, I'm using LibreOffice, it's a bit slow to update. But to do microservices, it's not only a technology choice, it's also an organizational choice. And many aspects have nothing to do with technology, right? But I stole this slide from another guy in Red Hat. You have those rights in roller coasters where the kids go and they say, oh, you have to be 1 meter, 20 centimeters to get into the ride. There are some things that you need to achieve first. So for example, you need to have some sort of self-service on-demand infrastructure. If you want to provision a new server and it takes a month, you're not doing microservices. Even if it takes a week, you're not doing microservices. You need to have go to a website, I have a budget, I click, poof, I have a new server. That's microservices. Deployment independence. So really the metric there is, can you redeploy your service without any downtime and without affecting negatively everyone else, you know, that's using your service? I think that's a, you know, break it or make it requirement. You need to own the full stack. So for example, if I need to update my service and then I have to talk to the database, you know, emperor, and require a schema change, and this will take, you know, 2 weeks and a few beers, then you're not doing microservices. And DevOps. DevOps, it's like you make it, you own it, you run it. In Google, when they make a new service, the team that makes the service owns the service for 6 months. And then another team takes over that owns the service. SREs, the site reliability engineers, which is a new role that you normally see now companies are advertising for. If it breaks, will they call you, you know, on midnight of Christmas? So, you know, that's another good way to know that I'm doing microservices. And then this automation, so you microservicing means that I have a server. It's mostly immutable. If it breaks, I throw it away. It's like a diaper. If it's dirty, you discard it. Our mothers used to wash the diapers. Yeah. So in a sense, you know, if you're still washing diapers, you probably you're not doing microservices. Continuous integration, continuous deployment. Everybody now does some sort of, you know, Jenkins or this sort of tools. But microservices mean that you have integrated in your pipeline also some automatic or semi-automatic way to put things in production. You know, it should come to your dashboard and say, I've checked in code, my code is stable, I run some tests, you know, I deploy in production. So that's the, you know, that's the target goal. And of course, you know, being agile in real terms, not just, you know, we're doing agile, but unless you have some form of Scrum, Kanban, combination, or, you know, you will not survive. You know, it's impossible to deliver stuff, even, you know, weekly. If you haven't really mastered this art. So can we raise hand? Who does microservices again? All right. Excellent. I told you it wouldn't be easy. So with microservices, we do have simpler services, but the functionality is still there. Somehow we need to do discovery, resource pooling, logging, monitoring, security, tracing, distributed transactions, compensated transactions, load balancing, messaging, you know, high availability, scale up, scale down. This has to live somewhere. The fact that it's not embedded in your application doesn't mean that it will disappear, okay? So for me as a application server writer, I've been doing this job for 15 years more or less, I think that looks like a distributed application server. I'm quoting myself. It is a distributed application server. We just took the functionalities there and distributed them in some environment that it's a bit of Wild West. Currently, everyone does whatever they want. There are no standards. If you start in one place, you cannot migrate to another competing implementation easily. There's nothing, right? And the role of companies like Red Hat is to come up with solutions that offer you this functionality in some integrated fashion. And for Red Hat, this is called OpenShift. This is our distributed application server. So to kind of conclude this short introduction, you know, going from monolithic applications to microservices, you know, it's quite a challenge. But there's also a lot of space in between. You don't have to go like full way into very small services. And there are a lot of different theories about it. So for example, some people say, okay, you have to go microservicey and to force yourself define those APIs, you know, early in the process. Some other people say, yes, but evolution of APIs is also something important. When you start the project, you probably don't know what are the correct abstractions. So you might end up with a microservice that you're not stuck. You have to maintain this wrong API, you know, for eternity or whatever. So there's another view that says, oh, microservices is great for second generation projects. So you build it once, you know your abstractions, and then you make those microservices. So you start taking slices of your original architecture and make it independently deployable. So I cannot tell you what to do. You know, you have to find out. That's the interesting part. But I think in this journey, it's important to choose the tools that they will let you make this transition, you know, smoother, and leave you the choice. Do I need a fat application, a slim application, anything in between? And sometimes when I talk with colleagues in Red Hat, you know, I make this joke. This picture is from 2001. For those that have been here long enough. When the Java EE specification came out, it prescribed that I have a web layer, and I have an EGB layer, and I have the database, right? And the vendors implemented it like this. I remember the first version of the Sun server, you know, there were different processes. And then this small project came, JBoss, back then, open source project, and say, oh, that's stupid. Why we don't just collocate those two layers, and suddenly it's 100 times faster. Because every time you cross the JVM boundaries, it's roughly, you know, two orders of magnitude slower. All the networking, serialization, security checks, whatever. So the truth of the matter is, for an average project, going microservices means that it's going to be slow before it can be faster, unless you reach this threshold where scalability, you know, kicks in, and then you really start going faster, then you're going slower. So that's just a small warning, you know, to understand the concept, because we've done distributed systems for a long time. We did it in the previous century, you know, so we know the pain point. So you can see the market going, you know, back and forth. So you really need to hit a balance. Okay, so a little bit about WildFly. Who knows what is WildFly? And who knows about JBoss? Okay, great. I won't expand. I just want to pinpoint a few things. So it's a project that's been here for a long time. It started in about year 2000. It has evolved over time. Now, what we have as WildFly is the old JBoss application server. And I think the interesting bit is to see how this project evolved in terms of kernel architecture. So JBoss was the first application server to have a microkernel. So that meant that you could plug in the various functionalities kind of dynamically. This architecture was later copied by everyone else. And we've reached, happily, the third generation of this architecture. After the micro container, we came up with something called the modular services container, which has still this unique characteristic that it's parallel. We soon realized that you cannot go faster on certain hardware. You can only go faster by threading for modern processors. So it's still the only server that can boot in parallel for in this space. And also it's fully modularized. We can have long discussions about modularity, Java 9, if you're interested, over beer. But the point I want to make is with those tricks, we managed to make a runtime that's quite fast. You can boot JBoss in 3.2 seconds on this four-year-old machine. And not cheating, that's not lazy loading, that's actually starting the services. And if you look at the configuration in JBoss, there's this file that more or less indicates, okay, what are the subsystems that I will enable? It's a list of those subsystems. And there were ways to trim this down. So for example, we have a configuration with less subsystems that more or less give you something that looks like Tomcat. And with those changes, you know, you can bring back bring down the boot time at 1.8 seconds. So we always had this idea that, you know, JBoss is really some sort of generic runtime. We use it to implement an EJB server, but you can implement pretty much any type of system with some properties. But we never actually reached a point where this customization is automatic and easily available to you guys until now. So welcome to WildFly Swarm. Swarm is a sister project to WildFly. It started as a research effort within the group to see how we can actually, you know, do this customization of the server based upon your deployments, your use cases. So the idea with Swarm and other projects as well, like Drop Wizard, Spring Boot, is to decompose the server and recompose it together with your application into a FAT jar, an executable jar. So then you have just enough application server for your use case, which for a long time, it wasn't really important because you used to say, you know, memory is cheap, disk is cheap, I don't mind, you know, I can have memory footprint not like super optimized. But the thing with microservices is that because now you don't have like one instance, you have like 100 instances or 1,000 instances. So suddenly memory became important again. So we have to slim down. And Swarm gives you this ability and a lot more as we're gonna see. So again, the general idea is you start from the server, you know, that's the application server. It includes all sorts of stuff. We bundle something like 200 components. But then when you create your own application, we will use only the pieces that are of interest to your application. And not only what the server can provide, but for those already doing microservices, you know you need this distributed application server thingy. Well, there are no standards, but there are a lot of, you know, useful components for, you know, single sign-on, circuit breakers, client-side load balances, reactive, blah, 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 you know, many, 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 many. So we provide those as well in an easy way to use. And why using Swarm? Again, there are other competing frameworks. I think the interesting bit is that you can stay within your knowledge domain. So this is still standard Java EE. There's nothing special. You can take an existing Java EE application and swarmify it, so to speak. Of course, you can add extra bits to, you know, talk with the cloud and do discovery. There's no standard yet. But you can keep building on your familiar technologies and use components that are very well tested. So for example, the transaction manager we use in JBoss is older than my nephew. It's like 20 years old, right? It's very well tested. And be part of this new brave world. And one example of that was that, you know, Java EE seemed to be stagnating at some point. Oracle was very slow to respond. Probably they didn't know themselves what they want to do. So at some point, Red Hat and some other vendors came up with a, let's say, a pre-standardization group with the mandate to experiment with Java EE and microservices and see if collectively as a community we can deliver something faster. We had to become more agile even in the standardization space. And we couldn't do it with Oracle at that time, so this group was formed. Last summer, we created a very small spec, which is to say we have micro profile and includes just REST, JSON processing, and CDI. So that's a minimal profile to make, you know, a small service REST-based. And Swarm is our, you know, contribution to this group. There are other groups that participate, IBM with the Liberty Profile, Payara server, what else? So, okay, back to Swarm. So, we have our Uber jar, which it's the executable jar with application server plus your applications. It contains what we call fractions. So fractions for us is the composition unit that offers a capability. And some other details to bundle this functionality, we create inside the jar a Maven repository. It's embedded. You don't see it normally. We have another mode as well. Because the application server part doesn't change much as you develop, you can choose to have a hollow jar that contains everything but your application. So application server customized for your application points to it, and you can deploy them, you know, together, but only update your app. And this might be important if you make, you know, very deploy many times a day. You don't want to carry to recreate the server and so on and so forth. So fraction. What is the fraction? It's the compositional unit. It provides a runtime capability and a way to manage it, to configure it. So the hard work is done by whoever writes the fraction. Some examples of fractions. Let's say we want to bring the distributed cache, a client to talk to a data grid. That's a fraction. Another fraction might be to register to a topology service, to a distributed directory. Other fractions can be used for distributed login, or just bring a Java EE API. So you want to use JPA, EJB, JAX-RS, the whole lot. Another fraction might be used to enable security. So the fractions themselves, you know, could be extra deployments, they could be interceptors added to your application dynamically, you know, all sort of stuff, anything to make it work. Now, the interesting bit is that Swarm is essentially a Maven-based toolkit. We have the Swarm plugin, so there's nothing to download, right? There's no zip. You include in your POM file a reference to the Swarm plugin, and then to refer to the various functionalities you want to use, you use Maven coordinates. In this example, you can see I want to access the undertow fraction. Undertow for us is an embedded web server that we have developed. And it's easy to remember that the versioning we use is just essentially a month. So 2014 May. In this example, every month we redistribute everything. We've been forced to become agile ourselves. And if you go to the website, you'll see we have many fractions, 169. They are categorized, stable, unstable, experimental. So you can, you know, have a look. And of course, you know, more is coming. So where do I start? We have a generator, like everyone else those days. So you go to the website, and then you can create a skeleton application to get started. So in this example, we go there, and we provide, I will create this application, you know, demo, com example demo, that's it. Now the interesting bit is that you specify the dependencies, what you want to bring into this application. And in this example, I said, oh, I'm going to make a microprofile application. If you remember, microprofile essentially means REST, CDI, and JSON. So this is kind of a pseudo fraction, just brings in dependencies. And when you click, you get back a small zip with a skeleton application, which in this case is just two things. It's a Java file and a POM XML. So let's look into it. We have some code as well. Yeah. So that's a very simple REST application. It includes just one endpoint that returns hello from WildFly Swarm. That's all it does. The interesting bit, you can see, this is standard Java, right? There is nothing non-stop. There's no spring there. Okay. All Java. And then, if we look at the POM descriptor, we have the, on the left, you see we enable the WildFly Swarm plugin, which just introduce the package goal. And we could leave it there without anything else. Now on the right, for this example, in the application we have dependencies like usual, you know. So we depend on the Java EE APIs, the standard APIs. And in this example, we depend on the micro profile fraction. We just reference it. Now this micro profile will bring others, as we will see. And then to build, there's no magic, just invoke the package target, Maven package. And then the normal Maven build process will happen, with the extra step to swarmify your app and produce the executable jar. So you will get also this demo swarm jar, which is the executable jar. And if we peek into inside, we will see there's actually the deployment, the demo war, it's there. And then there's this extra, you know, embedded Maven repository, some magic from Swarm to tie all those pieces together. And to run it, you know, it's executable jar, you just do Java minus jar, the name of the file. You can use a Maven target to run it, we provide the run target. And also, if you are inside an IDE, you can right-click the Swarm class, which is our entry point into the executable, or you have the option to provide your own name. We will see how we do that. And then you run it, you know. Java minus jar, my Uber jar. And if you're a bit familiar with JBoss, the boot looks kind of similar because it's WildFly underneath. But when it's the server starts, it will list you, okay, those are the fractions that I activate. And in this example, we can see, we had the micro profile. That's the one I've asked for, right? But I got 10. I've asked for one, I got 10, because this depends on others and the others depends on others. So you got 10 fractions. Those are installed. And if you look a little bit further, you see, okay, oh, the server has booted 1.8 seconds, which is, you know, not bad time. And then another 2 seconds to complete the deployment, and it's ready to go. There are other modes as well. So for example, if I don't specify any dependencies, there's something called the fraction detection mode, where the plugin will scan your classes, will look into the imports, and will try to guess, you know, what are you doing there? So in this example, if you try that, it will detect the JAX REST imports, and will guess, you're doing a REST application. So I'm gonna propose the REST fraction. So it tries to import the REST fraction, and this in turn depends on others. And if you run again, I did it like before the demo, before the presentation, you will see now the server is actually smaller. So I got REST, and this depending on the web server, Undertow, and also the logging framework. So it's a bit smaller, a bit better boot time, you know, shaved 400 milliseconds. So how we configure the fractions? Well, there are multiple ways. The easiest thing is, you know, everything has sensible defaults. So if you don't do anything, we will apply what we think is normal. You can override all the common settings, you know, through properties on the command line, on property files. There are many options. If you are like old school, because inside it's really WildFly, and if you understand about XML, there's nothing bad about XML, by the way. You can provide the descriptor or fragments of the descriptor for the subsystems you want to configure. That's also doable. And then if you really want to go expert mode, you take control of main, the main function, and you do it programmatically. And the way we do it is for everything that's like WildFly related, because in WildFly we have a very, very nice and complete configuration model. Everything is described by the schemas. We actually generate the fraction code that manages the fractions for configuration, because you know we have all the information. So we code generate the management part, meaning everything you have in the XML configuration is accessible for you. And to take control of the main, well, you have to provide the class, obviously. You have to tell Maven, oh, I'm using my main, don't use the swarm. And roughly what you do is, it's not too much actually, you can do it in three lines. You instantiate the swarm container that represents the server, and then you start adding fractions. So, fraction new, I'm doing Jax RS. And in this case, I'm accepting defaults. You know, just do all whatever you want. And when you're done, start the server, deploy the deployment. And that's it. That will create the equivalent result of starting Swarm with your main function. Some more complicated example. Setting up a data source. So the thing with data sources is that there's no reasonable default. You have to tell me which is the JDBC driver and where to connect to. You know, I cannot guess. So you can see how this Fluent API works. We have the data source function, and you start, you know, oh, okay, I'm doing a JDBC driver, H to type. I start giving, you know, that's the driver name, class, as you do it normally in XML or in any other way. There are some other things to, you know, ease how you configure the server. So for example, we support a YAML syntax in which it's common, you know, you develop your application, you have development environment, and then you want to move to staging, and then you want to move to production. So you list all the configuration overrides you want to do, and you say, oh, okay, that's the development stage, that's the production stage. And when you run, you can say, use this type of setting. So Swarm project stage, use production. So then logger goes into info level and I'm connecting to a different database. Whereas in development, I'm doing debug logging and something different. And that's pretty much it. I think I'm on time. For more information on Swarm or WildFly, you know, lots of resources. Swarm is a very dynamic, small project. If you want to contribute, we always accept, you know, new people, and you can enhance it, create a new fraction that doesn't exist. So there's quite a lot of work to do. And that's it. I think I can.
Thank you, Dimitri.
I can take a couple of questions.
I think you're definitely on time. You're not only on time, but you're also before time. So we have 5 minutes to spare. You've done very, very well conserving time. Questions for Dimitris? And I must say, I apologize for coming in late because I was doing some interviews out there. But any questions? Shall we have a short discussion for a few minutes? Yes.
Is there any centralized fractions repository? Does this make sense in this concept to have a centralized managed fractions repository that will be versioned as well?
Well, it's all Maven. It's all in Maven. Yeah. So we just push it to Maven Central.
Okay.
And that's it. The fractions, you can go to the website, and on this form you can see all the available ones. Okay. So that's the
second question here, and then one more there.
Hi. Could you please elaborate a bit on the OpenShift platform? You mentioned OpenShift earlier.
Elaborate. Well, OpenShift is the project that tries to unify all of Red Hat cloud-related efforts. And the idea is that on this platform, which is essentially Linux, Docker, Kubernetes, lots of services and the products integrated, you have an easy way to start something quickly, configure something quickly. There's all sort of things like, you know, there's some sort of website where you go and say, I want to create an application with XYZ components, poof, and you get the whole pipeline created, you know, repositories, CI, CD. There is even a new thing called a completely online interface. So you get an IDE in the cloud. You don't get anything local. So there's a lot of cool stuff to experiment with. So that's quickly what OpenShift is about.
I think we had one more question here.
Excuse me. Well, thank you for the excellent presentation. WildFly Swarm looks very, very nice. Normally, when you package an artifact, you want this artifact to be exactly the same on all environment it's going to run. So you normally externalize the configuration to the operating system, the application server, stuff like that. Does WildFly Swarm have any built-in support in order to do such a thing?
This thing I showed at the end, the YAML configuration, yep, is probably the closest thing that comes to mind. Or you can use property files, you know, they're the simplest.
So I'm going to have the YAML file which has built in the configuration for every possible environment, and then I'm going to indicate the environment I'm running in on the operating system. Yeah. Is that the case? Okay,
yeah,
perfect.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Okay. Dimitri, thank you very, very much. Okay, superb. All righty.